on the air and streaming on the web since 1996, this is the Cinematic Sound Radio Network. This is Talking Soundtracks with Jason Drury on the Cinematic Sound Radio Network.
Hello again, my name is Jason Drury and welcome once again to Talking Soundtracks on the Cinematic Sound Radio Podcast. Ian MacDonald has been a fan of John Barry even before the time when he became a celebrated film composer. In late 2022, he contacted Talking Soundtracks wanting to talk about his love of the music of John Barry and the stories he had in relation to his interest in the composer. In February 2023, via Zoom at his home in Bridgewater in Somerset, we did just that, as well as talking about, amongst other things, Barry's James Bond scores, his memories of the concerts he attended, and the time he met John Barry for the very first time at a recording session at Abbey Road Studios in London. We would take the opportunity to play music by John Barry. Ian MacDonald, welcome to Talking Soundtracks.
Thank you very much, Jason. It's good to be here.
Now, when did you first get interested in John Barry?
Well, a long, long time ago, when I was about 11 years of age in the year 1958. I've given my age away now. But anyway, it was really based on the old rock and roll craze of the day, because there was a TV show on at the time at 6:05 in the evening on BBC. And it was called the 6:05 Special. And I, like a lot of other young kids at that time, rock and roll was in and pop music was in its embryo stages, and I watched it mainly because it had steam railway and locomotives at the start, and that's what made me watch it firstly. And I got into the music in the show. The one thing that made my ears prick up, as they do when you get attracted to music, there was a certain band of seven musicians called the John Barry Seven. And I just liked the sound they made and the arrangements and the compositions that John Barry made for. They were very tight, very neat, very new. It was a new sound and it just attracted me. And from that point onwards, John Barry was, in those days, looking for an in, I think, to his eventual aim to be a film score composer. And this is a way of getting into the music business. And he then got a job with EMI Records as musical director, and it was a musical director to a very big pop star of the day called Adam Faith. He made one or two number one records with him and made a couple of albums, and I got very attracted to the John Barry sound. I used to like Adam Faith, but I realised very quickly that it was John Barry's unique sound that I was really attracted to, so I started to collect his stuff, and I went out and bought a 45 record with some money that my grandparents had given me for my birthday. And I went out and I think it was a record token they gave me. And I went out to the local record shop and I picked up this 45 single by the John Barry Seven called Bee's Knees. So that was my first intro to the John Barry's music. And from there it went. To me following his pop music career and following his many recordings with the John Barry Seven and the John Barry Seven and Orchestra, made lots of instrumental records, very, very different in style, which was a John Barry trademark really in those days. There wasn't really an established sound that you would associate with one artist. He tended to change things around very frequently, and he got into conjuring up the sound that everybody called string beat. And it was very much based on the Buddy Holly sound of the song It Doesn't Matter Anymore. It was around that style, around that time. Pizzicato strings, string orchestras, etc., twang guitars played by Vic Flick. And there were quite a few of the recordings that Burry made with the Seven made the charts, one of which was Hit and Miss, which was used later on as the theme for a BBC TV show on a Saturday night called Jukebox Jury. It outlined something as well. In the middle of that particular instrumental, there was a guitar lick in the middle, and it was very much more of a jazz guitar than a pop guitar. And it really outlined the fact that Barry, and I made it quite clear that Barry had studied jazz as part of his musical training, because that wasn't strictly pop music. It was, there was a theme, and then the middle part was very, very solidly guitar jazz. But it went on for various different instrumentals, and of course it all culminated more or less in 1962 with that little known theme that went to in at the start of, I mean, been included in every 007 movie since 1962, a little piece of music called the James Bond theme, which obviously everybody knows is probably the most prolific movie theme, I think, that's probably ever been written. Because it's lasted so long and it just doesn't sound as if it's aging. It's a classic piece. It was a story that I can tell you here if you'd like me to tell you that now. In 1968, there was a gentleman that worked for, he was the artist and repertoire manager at the record label called United Artists Stoke Liberty. They were based at 37 Mortimer Street, London, West 1. I remember the address very clearly. And a guy that was the A&R manager there was a man called Alan Warner. Now, Alan wrote a column every month in a magazine called Films and Filming. I made contact with him because he was writing a sleep notes on various albums at that time. And I made contact because at that time I used to bring up record companies to ask them if they had anything lined up for release by John Barry. And I got, it's quite a regular thing for me to ring and talk to Alan, and he would tell me when the next Bond score was coming out or when there were going to be a new reissue of something. We got to be sort of, if you like, sort of friends to some, to a certain degree. And one day he said to me on the phone, he said, tell me, have you got all the James Bond LP that you stole? I said, yes. He said, well, I'm thinking about putting out an album of all the best bits from the first four or five movies. It's going to be called The Best of Bond. It did come out as an LP. It came out with a red cover with a lady in a fedora on the front cover. And it was originally going to be put out as a double album. Alan was very keen on the James Bond theme, and he started to tell me that he was going to do a double album and the date folder, big fold out, and write a very long sleeve note. And at that time I said, what are you going to write on the sleeve note? And he said, well, I'm going to divulge the real story of this piece of music. I said, oh, that's interesting. What do you mean by that? I said, well, I think we all know that John Barry had more to do with the James Bond theme than he's given credit for. And what I intend to do is to write a sleeve note to tell the real story. I said, okay. He said, anyway, can you come into the office to bring those LPs in? Because I want to use them to photograph them. And he said, so that I can use it as illustrations on the cover. Oh, I said, okay, yeah. So I went into the office the following week. And I said, what's this sleeve note you're going to write in about the Bond theme? He said, well, let me show you. So he went to a filing cabinet in the corner, one of those old metal cabinets where the drawers were essentially locked by a Yale lock, if you like, at the top of the cabinet. And he got out this brown form folder, and in it was quite an extensive manuscript. And then when he got out, on the desk, he said, here he is. And I said, okay. It said on the top, the James Bond theme by John Barry. And it was the original manuscript, as written. It had various alterations, scratchings out, and notes at the side and what have you. But it was that, according to Alan, that was the original manuscript that Barry used to do the James Bond thing. He said, I can tell you now, it is the original one, he said, because it's been endorsed by the Performing Rights Society. And in those days, what they did, the composer signed it, and they put a wax seal over his signature. And next to that wax seal was a number. I think it was about 5 digits, the number. And it was one of those, it was done by one of those machines. You're all familiar with this, but one of these machines where you stamp something on a piece of paper, it gives a number. And then when you go to do it the next time, it's moved up 1 digit. And it's that sort of thing. And it was given a number. And that number was, according to that manuscript, allocated to the Performing Rights Society. So that, in not so many words, it actually... So as far as Alan was concerned, it proved that was John Barry's work. We did do the album. He submitted the sleeve note to the people at Eon, the powers that be at the Bond Empire. And I understand that when he told me about 2 or 3 weeks later, he said that, oh, he said I was going to do it. He said, but they won't let me print it because it's disclosing the fact that, and that they think, you know, I'm saying that Barry wrote the Bond theme, and they wouldn't let me put it on the LP as a note. So we had to reduce the LP back. So we scaled it back to a single album, and he put a very short note on the back of it. If you see the LP, you'll see his note on the back. And it was very much pasted down from what it was going to be originally. So that was really the end of that. He was quite convinced that Barry wrote the James Bond theme, and that was his proof. Now, what happened a little while later, Alan was at a sort of a brainwave, and he decided that he was going to launch a label called Sunset. And Sunset was a reissuing of quite a few of the soundtracks that were originally released on the EMI United Artists label in the 60s and probably early 70s. Things like 6 Breeze Squadron, Baron Goodwin, Phaedra by Mikis Theodorakis, the Bond themes, Goldfinger from Russia with Love, etc. And a few others. They were put out very cheap albums in those days at 99 pence each, which was a step. So basically, at the time, he also had plans to put out Dr. No as a re-release, because the original album of Dr. No came out, I think, in 1965, 3 years after the film. And it was obviously launched because of the popularity of the preceding two or three films. So he launched this label, and he had plans to re-release the score from Dr. No. While he was away on holiday, the lady that was his secretary, she evidently told him that during the time when he was away, some people came into the office who were working for Monty Norman, his agent, his agency, or whatever it was. They were connected to him. They came into the office. They said to view the contract. Don't know what contract they were talking about, whether they're talking about the original contract to score of the movie or the original contract to release the music. I don't know. But they asked if he could... he called me in and asked to see that contract. Now, in that folder where that contract was that manuscript we've just been talking about, which was Barry's original. And they inspected whatever they needed to inspect. No one quite knew what it was. And when they left, that was fine. And then when Alan came back from holiday, he went to the file to see if he could, he wanted to keep that manuscript because it was important. And when he went to the file, it was gone. It was missing. No one knows where it went, but I'm afraid that people have got to draw their own conclusions. It doesn't take much to work it out where it went. And the only reason I could say that that happened is because it was the overriding evidence of who wrote the James Bond theme, when it had to be, shall we say, lost or taken away or whatever, for Monty Norman to maintain the rewards of his just desserts, or not, as the case may be. So that is the theory. The only real conclusion that people can come to on that is that his office took that away. What they did with it, where it is now, nobody knows. It never shut up again. And Alan, when he rang that company to find out what happened to it, they denied all knowledge. So it went missing. So that was really, if that was had been presented in the 2001 court case at the High Court, when the Monty Norman sued the Sunday Times for printing the fact or non-fact, we wouldn't call it, that Barry wrote the James Bond theme. If that particular manuscript could have been reproduced at that trial, I think that would have been a different result. But of course, it wasn't, because it couldn't be. So there you are.
Now straighten me out here.
Yes.
The official composer listed on the credits is Monty
Norman.
Yes,
my God.
So what's the short version of the story?
I'll answer the question by asking a question.
Yes.
Which is, if I didn't write it, why did they employ me for the next 11 movies?
Right.
No more to be said.
We were talking about the 1960s. Which scores stood out for you in the 1960s? And what memories do you have, like, going to premieres of these films? Because I know you went to a number of James Bond premieres. Can you tell us about the stories you have of those and the films that stood out in the 1960s for John Barry, in your opinion?
One of the things I always associate with the 60s, it gave birth to so many great soundtrack albums, music-wise. Besides John Barry, I used to collect quite avidly the scores of Elmer Bernstein, Henry Mancini, and various others. If it was a good score, I bought it. I had a huge collection of LPs, and still do. The ones that stand out, I think, really, Bernstein, certainly The Great Escape and The Magnificent Seven, Walk on the Wild Side, which I absolutely love. I think it was a fabulous score. The Mancini ones, Two for the Road, Charade, Pink Panther, all that stuff. It was classic. It was a wonderful era to live through, because every week, literally, there was at least two or three soundtrack LPs coming out by various composers. It was a phenomenal period. so many albums, and you go into a record shop and you go to the films and shows section, and there'd be a couple of hundred albums sitting in there, you know, at any one time. It was just great to go into a record shop and see what those albums are about. I bought things like the ones I just mentioned, the Mancinis and the Bernsteins and Maurice Charles, Lawrence Arabia, obviously later on Dr. Zhivago. I bought quite a few of the Jours de la Rue, Precious Lay, Michel Legrand, oh, you name it. I was, I had a huge collection. I still do. I still have a lot of those scores now. I grew up with them, and they're part of my, what I regard as the soundtrack to my life, because I can more or less remember where I was when I saw the film and when I bought the soundtrack. It's something that's quite nostalgic to me, really, because I more or less grew up with that. And it was, as I say, it was a great experience, really, because you saw the evolution, not only of the music and the movies, but the whole music industry seemed to take off in the 60s. Everything seemed to happen at once. It was quite a phenomenal period. There's so many things happened. Stereo sound, colour TV, colour movies, you know. The Beatles, as Michael Caine once said, the Beatles ran the pop side, and it was old John Barry who ran the movie music. Very much in the 60s, John Barry was very much at the forefront of the evolution of film music in the 60s, very much so. And one of the things that I always admire about his particular scores is the range of films and different subjects that he rap, or he would abruptly turn around from doing something like Midnight Cowboy to something like The Lion in Winter or The Last Valley or something. And then you got the Bond films and you press fire on the map, and the range musically was quite stunning. The best thing I can say about John Barry in the 60s was you never knew what you were going to get next, because it was just very likely to be something completely different to what went before. And it was quite exciting, actually, because you never knew what you were going to get. And it was, it was a very interesting, very exciting period. One of the experiences I had in the 60s, I went to the Columbia Cinema in, I think it was Shaftesbury Avenue in the West End, to see a showing of King Rat, and got to the part of the film at the end, about 20-25 minutes before the end, getting quite interesting, I was going to finish, and lo and behold, everything went black. It was a power cut. So at that point, the manager came in with the torch in his face, a bit spooky, and proudly announced that we've lost power tonight and unlikely to get it back before in the next couple of hours. So of course, everybody had to sort of leave the auditorium or the cinema, and he said, what you can do is keep the ticket, and you can, if you want to, you can come back tomorrow night or the night after and see the film again at no charge. So that's what I did. I went out and I thought, well, I've got to see the end of it once Derek finished. So I went back in again the following night and I saw it again. So I had the two showings of King Rat, or should I say, 1 3/4. Thought it was a great movie. Again, it demonstrated John Barry's versatility musically to adapt to any kind of film. I mean, that was a good wartime prisoner of war story, and well acted with a great cast. You know, a well-made movie. One after that, I've got an invite. Well, I say invite. I've got a ticket for the premiere of the Bond movie, Thunderball, which was quite exciting. One of the things I noticed that went in there, and you're sitting in the audience, and there's that sort of buzz in the air, you know, that people are not quite sure what to expect, how it's going to happen, and they're all talking, and you can hear them murmuring in the air, the buzz, you know. And then suddenly, as that music came up, the first few bars of the Bond theme, it was like somebody had sliced the air and just cut all the sound out, because, and they stopped talking all at the same time. It was quite odd. It was like somebody turning off the sound on the radio or your TV. You know, instant stop. And we went up. And the film started. It was quite eerie, really. It makes you think you've lost your hearing or something, you know. And that was it. And that was the excitement of a Bond movie at that time. Another experience with a Bond that I can tell you about, a similar thing happened when I saw Goldfinger, previous to obviously the Thunderball, at the Hammersmith Odeon. I think I saw it on the second or third night or something. I got to Hammersmith to go and see this movie, and I came out of the station to go to the cinema, and all these crowds of people, God, it was people everywhere. And there were police horses controlling the crowd. And I thought, what's happened here? And it was to control the crowd for the queue to go to see the movie. And I reckon there must have been about a good 3/4 of those people outside there didn't get in. I was one of the lucky ones. I'd have picked to get my book previously. But again, I got in there and the same thing happened. You know, there was a lot of talking going on before the film started. But the thing that struck me in that movie is when the film started, and people stop talking and start suddenly take notice of what's on the screen. The thing that struck me most about Goldfinger for the movie when I first saw it was how what the effect was of those two opening bars of Goldfinger, the song. The way that it crashed onto the screen, it was similar to somebody throwing a couple of hand grenades at the screen. You know, bam, bam. It really threw you back in your seat. And you hear that lovely brass line in the middle, you know, that opens the song. It was stunning. It was a stunning experience. I always remember that. Whenever I hear that song, I remember that moment because it really was iconic. You sat there and looking at the screen, and suddenly there's two bars of the song came up. Wow, it was something else.
I sat down and wrote this rather strange melody, just based on the word Goldfinger, as the opening line. Then I'd worked with Shirley in concerts. I'd done concerts tours with her, and she was very big in England at that time. And Shirley has this one thing. She has such conviction about what she does. So I played her the song, and she said, well, what the hell is this about? It's about a villain, Shirley. I said, don't think too much about it, Shirley. Just go into the studio and convince the world that you know what you're doing. And you can do that, because I've worked with you in the theatre, and you do this better than anybody else I know. We then went in and recorded it. And originally it just started off with the chords, ding, dum, and there was no bar, yeah, 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 that wasn't there then. And we had a break, they went up for their 10-minute tea break, and in the tea break, I just found it, that what we were playing, that was empty, so I sat down at the piano and I came up with a da, ya, na, na, da, and did it on wow, wow trumpets, and we put that in, which just kind of brought it to life. And then we repeated it down the line.
I just enjoy that. I still watch Goldfinger now. It's one of the movies, I think, one of my favourite movies, really. I just think that the Bond films at that time had the suave image of Sean Connery, which I don't really think has been surpassed as Bond ever. I think, like most things, I think the original, the first one, was the most important one. And it's the one that makes him, that creates the impression and creates the part, but creates the image. Sean did a fantastic job in those films. He really was top notch. I really don't understand. I've never understood it. How we get to look at the history of the Academy Awards, and you don't find hardly a single Bond film in there for best film or best screenplay or best director or whatever, or even, come to that, best song or best score. Today, I find that some of the scores that get nominated for awards and win awards, God, you know, sorry, but, oh, not for me. I think back on them and I'm thinking, how the hell does we have all the time in the world not get a nomination for best song? How did Diamonds Are Forever or even Goldfinger not get a nomination?
I'm not saying that you'll win, but not to get nominated? Incredible.
Which was your favourite Bond film scores of the 60s?
I can't say I've got a favourite. I love them all, to be honest. I play them all equally, listen to them all equally now. I suppose the one that I'm the best, if I had to make a choice of the best film, it would be between two, and narrowly be For Russia With Love. I love the story, I love the Robert Shaw's Red Grant, and Lottie Lenoir, and all the other people that the old Bond crew in there. It was just a classic Bond film for me. It had a great story, really great story, based obviously on the original story by Ian Fleming, but yeah, and Goldfinger comes very closely behind. I like Diamonds Are Forever, but not quite so much. I found the first From Much With Love and Goldfinger and Thunderball probably the best ones, although I'm not overly keen on the underwater sequences of Thunderball. I found it a bit, to be honest, I found that a bit monotonous and a bit boring at the time. It goes on a bit too long for me. How can I put it? It's not real action as such. It's slowed down because it's underwater. And I didn't find it exciting, but that's just me. I went to the Odeon Haymarket to see The Lion in Winter when it first came out. And in those days, a lot of the main big movies, they would issue in the West End cinema the souvenir brochure, which are very collectible now. I've got various ones for Lawrence of Arabia, Dr. Zhivago, Lion in Winter, Bond 3, and a Bond 1, and all the rest of it. But they were always on sale in the foyer, and I always bought one. And they're really well produced, actually. But for Lion in Winter, it went a stage further. They actually sold the soundtrack LP as well in the cinema. And when I went in, I thought, oh, I'm going to buy that. It was coming out, I think, on the following Friday. This is a Tuesday night. And they must have had some advanced copies. So I thought, I'll buy one of those when I come out to the cinema. So I watched the film, came out, and I went to the lady that I saw selling them the LPs before the film started. I said, have you got any? She said, no. She said, we sold out. And they had something in it. I said, have you had? We said, we had about 300 copies, and they sold out. But one showing in a cinema film. And I couldn't get it, so I had to wait until it came out on the Friday in the shop. And, I thought, really? Yeah. I did obviously get it because it was habitual. I bought everything that John Barry did in the 60s. I mean, I don't think it's pretty boring, really, but it always surprises me when I see people on the John Barry Appreciation Society coming out and saying, oh, I've just found this soundtrack. I didn't know he did this, still. And I was thinking, crikey, I wish I could find something like that. Well, I didn't know, you know. I bought everything as it came out, and I had people looking out for me in case I missed something. And of course, my collection is pretty watertight on everything that he did. And I don't think there's anything that came out I haven't got. In a way, it's a shame because I miss out on that excitement of finding something you haven't got, you know. Hey-o.
Let's move down to the 1970s, and I know you went to a number of John Barry concerts in the 70s onwards. Can you have any memories of the early concerts you went to?
The first concerts of John Barry that I went to were back in the 60s, actually. I will cover the 70s one, but it's important to tell you about the ones in the 60s. There were the two road shows that he did with Shirley Bassey. Also on the same bill was Matt Monroe. John Barry did the first third of the concert with something in a legion of, I think, about a 20-piece orchestra, so you know more than that. And he did a number of standards. He did some film themes, and he did things like Man with a Golden Arm, Taste of Honey, Soul Bossa Nova, and things like that. He did a few well-known standards, Sing, 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 and he did a few big band numbers, and it does a Finado and things like that. And then the second half was Matt Monroe. Now, Matt Monroe, at that point, the orchestra was conducted by a guy called Johnny Spence, who Barry worked with on the score for Elizabeth Taylor in London in 63. And then in the last third of the show was with Shirley Bassey, with Barry conducting. I was always very fortunate in as much that I got quite a few invitations to quite a few things there. I used to work for the Daily Mirror newspaper in London, and I worked there from 1971 until 1988. And I used to have connections with journalists, some of which wrote for cinema reviews, film reviews, stage show reviews, etc., and advertising guys who actually negotiated with the agencies to place the adverts in the newspapers for the various films that came out in the cinema. One of the films, of course, was Moonraker, and I was lucky enough. I sit to a guy that was talking to an advertising agency that handled the advertising for Moonraker, an agency called Osborne Group Advertising. And I said, is there a press show? He said, yeah. I said, is there any chance of a ticket? He said, yeah, get your ticket for the press show. And I said, so I got a ticket for the press show at Moonraker, which was on a Monday morning at the Dominion Cinema in Tottenham Court Road in the West End of London. I went in there, I spotted going in Athena Ackers, who was with Lewis Gilbert, who was one of the James Bond producers, people that John Barry worked closely with. Anyway, I saw the film and I bumped into Athena, and she was with Lewis Gilbert afterwards. I think they were meeting up with somebody rather for a lunch or something, but I met them very briefly in the foyer after the film, and I said, oh, hello, Gina, I didn't know you were going to be here. What do you think of the film then? She said, well, she said, it's all right. I said, oh, I enjoyed it. I said, I love the music. Oh, she said, don't mention that music. I said, why? She said, oh, he's ever so upset with the sound and the way it came across. And she said, it isn't what he wanted to hear in the movie. I think that what we all know now is the mix. It was the mix of the sound that was done in mono as opposed to stereo, and it didn't sound as good, and Bo was very upset by that. I said, well, yeah, what did she think then? She said, he nearly gave up with it in the end. I said, what happened then? He said, that awful man, Sinatra, he wanted to run the place. He wanted to take the song and take it back to America and then go and record it in his studio with his musicians, his orchestra, his musical director. He wants them to arrange it in a way that he wants so that he can sing it the way he wants to sing it. And she said it just didn't work. And John simply turned around to him and said, sorry, Frank, but I'm the man who's put in charge of the music for the Bond film, and the person that does the recording, does the arrangement, conducts the orchestra and everything is me. And that's not really James. And he was backed up by Cubby Broccoli. Evidently, that Zena told me that Cubby got involved in the end, but he got a bit heated. And with that, Sinatra said, well, if I either do it my way or I don't do it. Told the tongue. That was the end of that. When she told me that story about the Moonraker song, I think it's pretty accurate. But she'd had no reason to tell something and it's not totally the truth. But she was told the story and she just relayed it to me. But I never saw it reproduced anywhere else in any publications, any newspapers or magazines or anything. So that's what she told me. I presume it's true. I had no way of telling because I didn't witness anything. So other than what she told me. So there you have it. That's the story.
I've noticed that you visited a number of recording sessions of John Bowie. How did that come about? And who did you meet on those recording sessions?
Right. Now, it was a rather lucky break, really. In 1997, I celebrated my 50th birthday. My wife was wanting to fix up something special for me to do to celebrate that, basically. So what she did, she wrote to Abbey Road Studios. And because I found out, I can't remember how I found out, but I found out that John Barry was recording at Abbey Road in April of 1997. He was doing a score to a film called Swept from the Sea. It was a score that John was recording with the English Chamber Orchestra. Anyway, I deviate. My wife wrote to Abbey Road. They wrote back to her saying, well, it's not really a good idea to write to us because we have no control over John Barry's movements, etc. If you write to the English Chamber Orchestra and this lady, then you might find they had more success. So she wrote to this lady at the English Chamber Orchestra, who was the orchestra manager, actually. She wrote, I was getting ready to go to work in the morning, and living in Devon at the time. That's where I used to live at the time. From the postman delivered the post, and there's a letter from the English Chamber Orchestra saying a lady called Pauline Gilbertson, who was the manager of the orchestra, she very kindly wrote to me, or wrote to us, to say that she'd spoken to John Barry and he'd be very happy for you to come along and sit in on the sessions for Threat from the Sea for the last 3 days of recording. When I was sitting on the outside, at the start of the day, I sat on the outside of the soundbox on the chair and John came up to me and he said, you must be Ian. And of course, you know what you're like, you know, you get to the situation like that and you suddenly, you get sort of lost for words. You're sort of making sort of a stuttering response, you know. It was a bit embarrassing, really, but not usually like me. I'm not usually like that, but anyway, Yes, that's me. Yes, thank you very much for asking me. It's Tetris. And yeah, it's great. You said I won't have a chance to talk to you now. He said, but at the end of the day, we have a little chat. So I thought, oh, that's great. Thank you.
Well, I brought my camera and, of course, an LP to sign, which was The Last Valley. I watched the day's proceedings, which was very interesting. And during that time, that day, who came into the studio, it was a bit like a hotel, really. We had Don Black, David Arnold, Jane Seymour, Martin Caine, and the director of the film was a lady. She was there anyway. I saw a bit of the real skill of scoring a movie, because there was a scene they were discussing, and I think it's the scene at the start of the film, and it showed Rachel Boyd, who played the part of Amy, standing on top of a clifftop on the North Cornish coast, pointing out to sea to explain to the child where his father came from. John Barry had to portray in music the fact that she was telling a story to the son. And when this music was playing, the music was going over the top of the sound of the surf. So it didn't quite sound right. And John said, that's wrong. So he went out and said, that's like that. He said, that sound of the music should be underneath the main soundtrack of the film. It shouldn't be over the top. He went out to a guy who played a synthesizer, and he took the score to him, and he said, can you play this and take it an octave lower? Well, I said, yeah, no problem at all, yeah. So he went out, and they did the track again. This time it took out, I think it's about five or six string players and a harp or something, and they didn't play, but instead the synthesizer took over and did that part for them. And when he came back into the sound room, and they played that piece of music back, the very same piece of music on the same scene, you wouldn't believe the difference. It was suddenly, you think, yeah, that's right. That's exactly what should be happening. Because you heard the surf, but the music was underneath, so to speak, sound-wise. It wasn't drowning it. It was letting the sound effect of the scene take over. That was really a touch of genius, you know. He seemed to hear musically exactly what he needed to do to change that scene and the effect of the music in it. That was quite stunning. But yes, it was a lovely day. At the end of the day, Louis said to me, have you put your camera on? I said, yes, I have. He said, well, come out, let's go out and see John and we'll take some photographs. So I have a photograph now on my wall here, taken on the podium of Abbey Road, of me and John together, shaking hands at that. The recording session, that is obviously a very treasured photograph. You know, very special day, very special experience. And at the end of the third day, when it was all finished, John had to rush off to the record company because they were going to negotiate the soundtrack album or something. And Laurie, before they left, Laurie turned around to me and said, well, lovely to meet you. If you're in London again when we're recording here, you'd be very welcome to pop in. Thank you very much. You know, so I ended up going to go back to the last day of seeing the album Eternal Echoes recorded with the English Chamber Orchestra again, where I had another chat with a nice young gentleman called Nick Rayner, I'm sure you know. Nick, at that time, obviously, was John's orchestrator, but later he recorded a number of, you probably realise, a number of John Barry scores with the City of Prague Philharmonic. Pretty good recordings too. And I had quite a nice long chat with Nick. And it was a great experience because there were some great people there to talk to. One of the guys that was instrumental on the days that John Barry recorded with the English Chamber Orchestra, one of the things that's very instrumental was his fixer, was a guy called Christian Rutherford. And Christian was a great-grandson well, the famous actress, Margaret Rutherford, who was in the Miss Marple's films, and I think she was in Airport as well, the 1970 movie of Airport, amongst other things. And he's her great-grandson, and Christian was the fixer of the orchestra. So he fixed up how many players we have in the orchestra, how many violinists, how many percussionists, and so on and so forth. There were several lovely people to talk to that day. It seemed that John Barry had this attraction that whenever he's writing the score for a film, the people that are connected with it and acting in it want to see him recording the music. lastly, on the recording session side, I got a phone call because I made a bit of a friend or Christian Rutherford. He used to ring me up, and he was the one who told me about the session for Eternal Echoes. But he did ring me a year or so later, and he said, "I'm sure you'd be interested to come along to this." He said, "John's been asked to rescore the end titles of a film called Enigma." And I got asked to go to that. The recording went well. And lo and behold, that turned out to be, quite sadly, when he finished that, it turned out to be the very last time that John Barry would conduct music to film. That was the last time when he walked out of the studio. That was it. And nobody, of course, realised that at the time. You know, it was in some ways, it was very sad. Now I look back on it. Nobody, I think someone said to him on the way out, "See you next time, John, you know, I look forward to working with you again." And he turned around and he said, "Yeah, maybe." Very telling words. Wasn't to be. It didn't happen, did it? And not at all. So that's that, really.
How do you feel John Barry was treated towards the end of his career? Because I noticed a number of his scores were rejected in that time.
Yeah, I think it... I'm not sure about that. I don't know an awful lot about it, to be honest. I wasn't party to any of the information as to why he turned down various jobs. I think he fell out of love a bit with the movie scoring industry when things changed. I remember him doing an interview with Aidan Gormley of RTE in Dublin, when he was they did a concert in 2008, which Nicholas Dodd conducted. And he was interviewed by Aidan Gormley, lady who worked for RTE. And he was asked about state of music and film. And I remember him coming up with a very telling statement. He said that there are many great composers and great musicians working in the field today, and they're writing some great music. But what they're not writing is great melodies. And he said, "That's a part of the movies for me that has always got to be there. You have to have a central theme that you're going to work on." If you look at Barry's scores, usually you can get a theme and you can run it through the film in various places, because you hear little snatches of it here and there. And it gels the thing together. And I think when directors started to meddle, if you like, if you want a good example, think about the James Bond films, separating the song from the score. You remember with Goldfinger and Thunderball, the theme reappeared in the film, the song. You know, the melody of the song reappeared in the film several times. And that was the way Barry worked. And when that was taken away, and the demand for music in film was such that the melodic theme and the, if you like, the commercial theme was no longer required, I think he fell out of luck with it a bit. I think he thought, well, that's not what I want to do anymore. It's something I don't want to be associated with. And I think at that point, maybe his health was failing a little bit. I'm not sure. And I think he might have felt, you know what, this is the time. I think I've had enough of it. And I'd have liked to see him score a few more films. And I understand he was offered a few more films, but I don't know whether the energy was there at the end. I think it's like I was really. I mean, you get to an age in life where the zest goes, you know, it's the energy. I mean, to his great credit, John Williams is, what, 90 now? And, yeah, I mean, it's astonishing what he's doing. I greatly admire that man, I really do. He's really, I think he's only one of two of the greats from the 60s still surviving, and himself and Lionel Shiffrin, maybe. And I think that's it. And after him, you're thinking, how sad is that, you know, that all these guys that I grew up with are now no longer with us. It's very, very sad, really.
Thank you.
What, in your opinion, made John Barry stand out from other composers?
One thing I always think he had more of than anybody else, especially in this period between, 1963 and 1970 maybe, was the originality and the range of films that he scored and the range of music that he wrote. I mean, Bond, Line in Winter, Walkabout. I know Walkabout was maybe in the 70s, Midnight Cowboy. Just a range of movies, different scores, different styles. As I said earlier, you never knew what you were going to get with John Barry because all the films were different and diverse subjects. And of course, he would always, when scoring a movie, make sure that he understood exactly what that movie needed. And that, I think, was his great gift. He was a great musical dramatist. He could paint the characters in music. He could create the mood of the film. He could connect with the film and the script and the story. And the music, you would think, you know what? Nothing else would have fitted. That is absolutely perfect. I mean, if you hear the main title to Body Heat, for instance, I know that's the 80s, but you listen to Body Heat, you listen to Bond 3, you listen to The Bond, nothing else would have fitted. That is perfect. It's a wonderful gift to be able to just dramatically turn around and do something completely different with his next job. You know, when you went from Midnight Cowboy to Line in Winter, what a contrast. You know, it's incredible. On the John Barry Appreciation Society, we regularly have polls as to what is your favourite this and what is the best of that. And I'll sit there and I hold my head in my hands and thinking, how the heck can these people say that's their favourite? Because I just like them all. I can play anything that Barry's done. And I'm probably biased and I fully admit to that. But I can play anything that John Barry has written or recorded and enjoy it because I understand the medium and why it's what it is. If you understand what the music is conveying and the story behind the music, you can appreciate it. That's why I don't have favourites. I can play any of them and enjoy them, but I enjoy them for what they are. Really and truly, I love them all. I haven't got favourites. I can just play anything. I haven't got any favourites. I've got some I like more than others and maybe some I play more than others, but I do play them all.
finally, what, in your opinion, is John Barry's contribution to the development of film music?
I think he came into film music at a very important time. It was a very revolutionary time because it was the time when Very Own Sound came about. Film themes were becoming popular and it needed composers to come in that can write a tune and write a theme that people come out of the cinema with it in their head. I think he contributed greatly to that.
We have all the time in the world. Time enough for life to unfold all the precious things love has in store. We have all the love in the world. If that's all we have, you will find we need nothing more. Every step of the way will find us with the cares of the world far behind us. We have all the time in the world just for love, nothing more, nothing less, only love.
Sadly for me, and sadly for many other people as well, he didn't have all the time in the world out, John. He passed on in 2011, which was a very sad day for me, which I still remember each year, as I do a lot of other members of our John Barry Appreciation Society. And to be honest, although the man has passed and given me, especially me, I mean, from my point of view, many great memories, that music will live on for tens of years, no question. It's great stuff. I'm a great composer.
Ian MacDonald, it's been an absolute pleasure listening to your reminiscences of the work of John Barry and your stories. It's been a real pleasure having you on Talking Soundtracks. Thank you very much for joining us.
Well, thank you, Jason, for having me on. I've really, really enjoyed it. I always enjoy telling the stories, reminiscing, remembering, and I hope all your listeners enjoy it too.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to our chat with John Barry fan Ian MacDonald on Talking Soundtracks on his Cinematic Sound Radio podcast. So as I say at this point, the Talking Soundtracks theme was composed by David Cusina. My thanks again for Ian MacDonald for joining us on Talking Soundtracks on his Cinematic Sound Radio podcast. And until we meet again, for me, Jason Drury, it's take care and happy listening.
Thank you for tuning in to the Cinematic Sound Radio Network. You can find us on social media at Cinsound Radio on Twitter, and Cinematic Sound on Facebook. And if you listen to us on Apple Podcasts, please take a moment right now to rate the show and write a brief review. Reviews help introduce potential listeners to the show. And don't forget to check out Cinematic Sound Radio at cinematicsound.net.